LA to minus 2,900.
Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin are deep into their 13-minute descent to the surface of the moon. Their attention is focused firmly inside the cabin of their lunar module Eagle as they monitor the vast array of readouts and controls. But just for a moment, seconds before the 1202 computer alarm crisis that will threaten their landing, Aldrin's eyes are drawn, briefly, back home.
Roger, we copy.
At the Earth, right out our front window.
The Earth, outside their window, rising majestically above the lunar surface. An arresting sight. But they're not the first people to witness it. That honour had been taken 7 months previously by the crew of the most daring mission of the whole Apollo programme. Apollo 8.
We've got it, Apollo 8 now in lunar orbit. There's a cheer in this room. This is Apollo Control Houston, switching now to the voice of Jim Lovell.
The Earth from here is a grand oasis of the big vastness of space.
I could completely hide the Earth behind my thumb. Everything I ever knew, I could hide behind my thumb.
We choose to go to the moon.
Capcom, we're go for landing.
Eagle Houston, you're go for landing. Over.
Plus 2-5.
Give us a reading on the 1202 program alarm.
Hold to that 18 foot. We're going to make it a thing.
Roger.
Low level?
60.
60 seconds.
We've had you down.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
We celebrate Apollo 11 for making that historic first landing on the moon, but without Apollo 8 as pathfinder and pioneer, it could never have happened. The first mission to cross the quarter of a million miles between Earth and Moon, to NASA insiders, Apollo 8 is viewed as the gutsiest mission in the agency's history.
This to me was looking at new territory, new exploration, especially on the far side of the moon.
We don't want to just go to the moon. We want to go in orbit around the moon. Now, frankly, that's an order of magnitude difference in risk right there.
I remember hearing rumors that, oh, well, they're going to fly 8, you know, before the end of the year. And when I would hear those rumors, I would think, well, that's absurd. There's no way that's happening. We were not ready.
In this episode, I'll be talking to Captain Jim Lovell, a member of the crew that travelled further and faster than anyone had ever gone before. Apollo 8, the giant leap that made Neil Armstrong's small step possible. I'm Kevin Fong, and from the BBC World Service, this is 13 Minutes to the Moon. Episode 6, Saving 1968.
Here they come. They're charging into us. They're just swinging into this crowd. They're pushing the crowd. It's a stampede.
There goes a big blast of tear gas. I can't see.
He got me in the face. Oh, man.
1968 has been described as the year that shattered America. There were violent clashes between the authorities and demonstrators against the United States war in Vietnam. Americans had been told that their soldiers were winning the war. But in 68, the Viet Cong fought back, launching surprise attacks across the south of Vietnam, which turned the tide of the conflict.
This is the main South Vietnamese language radio station of Saigon, and right now some of the Viet Cong are inside occupying the station. There's a Viet Cong machine gun in there. About 100 yards away.
And on US soil, the country was rocked by the political assassinations of civil rights campaigner Martin Luther King and Senator Robert F. Kennedy.
I have some very sad news for all of you. Martin Luther King was shot and was killed tonight in Memphis, Tennessee.
Senator Kennedy has been shot. Is that possible?
No.
Is that possible?
No.
It could
be.
Is it possible, ladies and gentlemen? It is possible. He has. Not only Senator Kennedy. Oh, my God. Senator Kennedy has been shot. And another man.
The two deaths traumatized the nation and caused outrage. In the week that followed King's murder in April, there were riots in more than 100 cities nationwide. 39 people were killed. Thousands were injured or arrested. The United States was in turmoil. So too was the Apollo program. In 1968, still recovering from the Apollo 1 fire, NASA's goal of getting a man onto the surface of the moon before the end of the decade looked to be slipping beyond their grasp. To make matters worse, the Saturn V rocket NASA had chosen to use for the Apollo program was malfunctioning. In a 2008 NASA interview, Chris Kraft, who was in charge of NASA's human spaceflight program, remembers a troubled test flight of the Saturn V rocket in April 1968.
It was a disaster. I want to emphasize that. It was a disaster. That doesn't come out anywhere, but it was, I want to emphasize, a disaster.
The Saturn V had three rocket stages, and to get a crew to the moon, all of them had to function perfectly. But in April 1968, the only thing they all had in common was that none of them worked. The first stage failed so badly that it nearly shook the entire rocket to pieces. As you can hear, even decades later, Chris Kraft was still deeply unimpressed by that test.
Here's the Saturn rocket that everybody thinks is a wonderful piece of hardware that almost busted itself into pieces in all three stages the last time it flew.
NASA had less than 2 years to land a man on the moon, and they still hadn't sent a crew beyond Earth orbit. Then, two more pieces of bad news. Construction of the lunar module had fallen way behind schedule, and it wouldn't be ready for the first test flight. Worse still, the CIA passed on intelligence suggesting that the Soviet Union were planning to jump ahead with their efforts and put a cosmonaut in orbit around the moon in the next few months. NASA had to do something. In August 1968, flight controller Jerry Bostick was called in to see Chris Kraft. Kraft had been in secretive talks with Apollo boss George Lowe. Together, they'd hatched an outrageous plan.
Chris said George Lowe wants to go to the moon on the next flight after Apollo 7, if it's successful. And we all said, you gotta be crazy. And he said, no. Don't say that. That's what I said at first, you know. But think about it, analyze it, come back Monday morning and tell me if we can do it or not.
Once again, NASA had trusted some of its youngest people to make a momentous decision. And the kids in control, like 29-year-old Jerry Bostick, embraced the opportunity. Chris Kraft remembers the scene when he returned to his office after that weekend.
I couldn't get into my office, and they were there. They wanted to talk. They came in, and they were excited as hell. And they talked about, we think it's a great idea. We think we don't know whether we can do it or not. We think it's worth a try. We think we ought to do it. But they said, there's one thing we want to do, which you haven't mentioned, and which you probably are going to be upset about, and that is we want to go in orbit around the moon. Now, frankly, that's an order of magnitude difference in risk right there.
They would send a crew around the moon for the first time, extending their reach in space from Earth orbit at 250 miles to 250,000 miles. That would require incredibly precise guidance and navigation, which would put NASA's mathematicians and their machines to the ultimate test. But although this was a truly bold mission, some members of Apollo 8's crew admit to being a little underwhelmed, at least at first. The commander would be Frank Borman, As a fighter pilot, he'd flown combat missions in Korea and regarded space as another battlefield.
I was a Cold War warrior, and the whole program, the whole Apollo program, was far from just a demonstration of technology. It was really a battle in the Cold War, and that's why I was there. I had really no interest in picking up rocks.
Bill Anders had been hoping for more. He'd trained alongside Neil Armstrong to land the lunar module on the moon. But Apollo 8 would be leaving that vehicle behind on Earth.
When they took the lunar module away from our flight, I knew that that was kind of the death knell of my chances of walking on the moon. Frankly, I was quite disappointed initially, but I could see that, it wasn't that bad a gig anyway.
But then there was Jim Lovell, a former Navy test pilot for whom Apollo 8 represented an opportunity for pure adventure.
I was absolutely delighted. This to me was a mini Lewis and Clark expedition, looking at new territory, new exploration, especially on the far side of the moon.
Apollo 8 was really the most audacious of the Apollo project missions. So many firsts. Did that not factor into the way you felt about it? I mean, the risk was enormous.
We understood the risk, but this was a chance where you trade off risk for reward. And this certainly was, at least to me, the reason why I was at NASA in the first place.
Commander Frank Borman compared training for Apollo 8 to drinking from a fire hose, because they had to learn so much so quickly. Ordinarily, crews and engineers had 6 months to plan for a mission. For Apollo 8, they had just 4. The astronauts were amongst the first to learn of the secretive mission, leaving the engineers and scientists on the ground to play catch-up. Among the people who initially weren't in on the big secret was Poppy Northcutt.
I remember hearing rumors that, they're going to fly 8, before the end of the year. And when I would hear those rumors, I would think, well, that's absurd. There's no way that's happening.
In the summer of 1968, Poppy was a 25-year-old mathematician. She was the first woman to work in mission control as an engineer. The precise path the spacecraft needed to take to get back from the moon depended directly upon Poppy's calculations and computation.
We had to calculate the angles at which the engines were fired and how long the engine was fired in order to get them on a correct path to come back to the Earth within the reentry corridor. Because if you weren't within the reentry corridor, you'd burn up probably. My recollection is that working was about the only thing I did. Really, truly. Saturdays, Sundays, nights, just working. You worked till you dropped, you went home, you slept, and then you came back and you worked some more.
Pulling out all the stops, NASA's energetic workforce had decided that they could just about get Apollo 8 around the moon and back to Earth on schedule. But as flight controller Jerry Bostick told me, it wouldn't be without risk.
Apollo 8, when first presented to us, was a tremendous challenge.
And what did you think the chances were that you'd pull it off successfully?
I didn't ever put any odds on it. I didn't accept anything except, no question, we're going to do it.
For the astronauts, the risks were all too real. Privately, Bill Anders did think there was a good chance he wouldn't be coming home, something he shared with his wife, Valerie.
I told her quite frankly that this was an extremely important flight. I was really lucky to have it, even without a lunar module. We, the crew, had one chance in three of a successful mission. We had one chance in three. The mission wasn't successful, but at least we didn't crash. And then one chance of three of not coming back, which is probably as good odds as I would have had in Vietnam. She accepted that, and we focused on getting the job done, she raising the kids and me learning how the spacecraft worked.
The media were grimly fascinated at the idea that the crew might end up lost in space.
Here's the BBC's aerospace correspondent, Reg Turnill, talking to NASA's medical director, Dr. Charles Berry, the day before Apollo 8's launch, and asking him whether any special arrangements had been made.
Well, Dr. Berry, now the question that everybody wants to know the answer to, if these men do get stuck in lunar orbit, have they got a death pill to take so they can die painlessly?
No, and I suppose somebody would bring up the sleeping pills that we have aboard, and there aren't even enough of those to kill anyone, and so we've never felt that such a pill was necessary. The death would normally occur when the oxygen ran out, and when you lost your oxygen, hypoxia, or lack of oxygen, is a very painless death, and so we don't feel any need for anything of that sort.
And no doubt while they had oxygen, they'd keep trying to get back.
Oh, yes, I'm sure they would, and they'd keep functioning as the good test pilots that they are.
On December the 21st, 1968, astronauts Frank Borman, Bill Anders, and Jim Lovell were strapped into the command module on top of their Saturn V. This was the rocket we heard Chris Kraft describe earlier as a disaster. Assured that all the flaws had been fixed, this was the first time it would be launched with a crew on board. The first all-up test of the vehicles and equipment that would be needed to cross the void of space between the Earth and Moon.
T-minus 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9. We have ignition sequence start. The engines are on. 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. We have commit. We have lift off. 7:51 a.m.
Eastern Standard Time.
We have cleared the tower.
Roger. Honey here, Houston. Roger, clear. All right, North Point Bravo, Apollo 8.
On board, Bill Anders was experiencing the genuinely awesome power of the Saturn V.
The launch was a big surprise. It was violent. And I thought to myself, you know, what the hell? You know, if we thought we trained for everything, but we missed this one, what else did we miss? It was so loud, we couldn't communicate with each other. It was so violent.
Apollo 8 Houston, you are go for staging, over.
And then when the first stage burned out, suddenly we went from 6 Gs to slightly negative G, and I felt like it was being catapulted through the instrument panel. Threw my hands up inadvertently, and when the second stage cut in, my wrist ring came back and gashed my helmet visor, and I thought, uh-oh, you know, here I am, the rookie, and I'll have this cut on my visor. Well, when we got into space, I collected the helmets. I found that the other two guys each had scratches on their visors. So when you're riding the Saturn V, everybody's a rookie.
The Saturn V had successfully launched the astronauts into Earth orbit. But now the rocket's upper stage had to fire its engine and put them on course for the moon. And this would take them into uncharted territory. NASA called this Translunar Injection, or TLI, but flight controller Jerry Bostick has a slightly more straightforward way of describing it.
Shooting for the moon is like duck hunting. You don't shoot at the duck. You shoot out front and let the duck, you know, fly in. But in this case, we were shooting for a distance of 60 miles in front of where the moon would be when we got there. And so, you know, it took us hitting the right spot in space and God bringing the moon in at the right time to all match up.
The spacecraft had to arrive at the right altitude above the moon, at the right speed, the right angle, and at the right moment. TLI would put them on course for that point in space. The precise trajectory was worked out before the mission, and the launch date chosen to give the spacecraft the shortest possible journey to the moon. This hugely important calculation was done by a team of NASA mathematicians, including the woman nicknamed the Human Computer, Katherine Johnson. She turned 100 in 2018, but here she is talking to public service TV station WHRO in 2011.
Equally important when we're going to the moon, you had to know the location of the moon and where it was when you took off and where it was when you got there. See, the moon is going that way and you were going this way because you want to intersect the moon in a certain way. It was intricate, but it was possible.
Katherine's maths are a thing of legend, immortalized in the Hollywood film Hidden Figures and the basis for TLI, Translunar Injection, a landmark moment in the history of human exploration, the first time any human being had ever left the confines of Earth orbit, and in retrospect, perhaps it should have been accompanied by a bit more ceremony.
Apollo 8, Houston.
Go ahead, Houston.
Apollo 8, you are go for TLI. Over.
That's Mike Collins, who 7 months later would be the command module pilot for Apollo 11. But for Apollo 8, he was on duty as Capcom in Mission Control, tasked with passing instructions to its crew. And he wishes that he hadn't let that moment in history pass by quite so casually.
When the time came for it to be the first craft ever to reach escape velocity, the first craft ever to go so high with people on board, the first craft that was going to go to the moon, what did I do? I said,
Apollo 8, you are go for TLI. Over.
There ought to be bugles. The President of the United States should be here. The Pope should issue a writ. There should be rejoicing worldwide, and instead of that, I say, Apollo 8, you're go for TLI. And Frank, he was no better than I was. He said, Roger, Houston.
Roger, understand. We're go for TLI.
And I thought that was a terrible way to treat such a historic event, but that's what I was stuck with.
The Pope may not have been there, but with the rocket engines burning and accelerating them to 25,000 miles per hour, Borman, Lovell and Anders were on their way to the moon.
Apollo 8, Houston, you're looking good here, right down the center line.
Roger, Apollo 8.
They were travelling faster and further from home than anyone before them. The first people in history to break the bonds of Earth's gravity. Apollo 8 had begun its three-day, quarter of a million-mile journey to the moon. Just like the sailors who first crossed the Earth's great oceans, they were on a voyage into the unknown, and their journey shared much in common with those ancient mariners. As navigator, Jim Lovell used the stars to fix their position and check that the spacecraft's guidance computer was on track and doing its job. And Frank Borman probably felt a little like he was on a ship in rough sea when he became the first person to suffer from space sickness. Borman remembers it well.
When I got up to go beneath the seats where we slept, I got nauseous. Probably the first case of space nausea. The reason I discounted it was because I'd flown for 2 weeks in Gemini without any problem at all, but in Gemini you couldn't move around, you stayed in your seat, and so I think the difference was with Apollo, with the moving around.
If things were bad for Frank Borman, spare a thought for Jim Lovell, sharing the cramped confines of the Apollo command module.
He vomited, and he had diarrhea, and he had stuff was all over the place. And that's another bad thing about zero gravity.
Frank Borman's ailments would help open NASA's eyes to the wider biological and physiological hazards of spaceflight. It's that challenge that eventually led me to work with NASA at Johnson Space Center in the field of space medicine. Because wherever exploration goes, medicine must follow. Three days after launch, Apollo 8 was approaching its destination and about to face one of the riskiest maneuvers of the mission.
Apollo 8, this is Houston at 6804, you're go for LOI.
Okay, Apollo 8 is go.
You're riding the best bird we can find, over.
Thank you.
LOI, Lunar Orbit Insertion, the critical moment at which a human crew would attempt to get into orbit around the moon for the first time. To do that, Borman, Lovell and Anders would have to fire their rocket engine at exactly the right moment, to slow down by exactly the right amount, at exactly the right time. Performed perfectly, that action would allow the moon's gravity to pull the spacecraft into lunar orbit. But it was far from a foregone conclusion, and NASA had its own way of talking about the substantial risks. Flight controller John Aaron.
They can come around and be in the right orbit, or if they burn too long, the orbit may be too low, and you have to do an evasive maneuver. Of course, then there's the case of if they overburn too bad, they might not show up at all.
And by not show up at all, you mean just skip past the moon and keep going?
Well, or they burn so much they intersect the moon.
And by intersect the moon, I mean that's a euphemism for have crashed into the moon.
Crash, yeah, that's euphemism. that's another way of saying crash, yeah.
To make it even more nerve-wracking, the manoeuvre had to take place while the spacecraft was on the far side of the moon, out of contact with mission control and in radio silence.
1 minute to LOS, all systems go.
Thanks a lot, troops. We'll see you on the other side.
This static is all Jerry Bostick could hear in his headphones while the crew were out of contact.
It was a nerve-wracking time. When we had loss of signal as the spacecraft went around behind the moon, everything looked okay. But Glenn Lunny was on the console as the flight director at the time. Glenn said, okay, guys, it's a good time to take a break. And the first thing I thought was, Glenn, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. Here we've got three Americans, you know, behind the moon, first time ever to leave planet Earth, and you're saying, take a break? And then I thought, well, you know, that's probably the smartest thing he's ever said, because there's not anything we can do. So everybody rushed to the bathroom and came back. And it was a strange feeling of not being able to do anything or to know really what was going on.
Poppy Northcutt was also among those waiting in mission control. If something went wrong, she and Jerry Bostick had to be ready to spring into action to make the calculations necessary to rescue the mission.
We know when they're supposed to come out on the other side, when we're supposed to get what they call AOS, acquisition of signal. So at the front of the room, they have a countdown clock, so we know when acquisition of signal is supposed to be, counting down the seconds. You know, if they're late, that's not good. If they're early, that's not good. They were late coming out from the backside of the moon.
NASA's commentator Paul Haney kept the listening audience up to date on the agonizing wait for the astronauts to come back into radio contact.
Apollo Control Houston, we've heard nothing yet, but we're standing by.
It seemed like forever. It was an eternity. Everyone is sitting there not knowing what has happened. Is it that they're really okay, but you just have a communication problem? Was the burn bad? What happened? You can hear the Capcom calling out.
Apollo 8, Houston, over.
And there's no answer.
This hiss of static is the sound of NASA's worst nightmares. And there's time here to imagine it all. A spacecraft smashed into the surface of the moon, or lost forever having failed to get into orbit. And then, finally.
Go ahead, Houston, Apollo 8.
Apollo 8, this is Houston. Roger, good to hear your voice.
Finally they respond. Everybody breathes a sigh of relief that we at least know that they're alive.
Not just alive. It's a perfect burn and a pioneering moment in the history of human spaceflight.
We've got it. Apollo 8 now in lunar orbit. There's a cheer in this room.
Apollo 8, Houston, what does the old moon look like from 60 miles, over?
Jim Lovell was taking his and humanity's first close-up look
at the lunar surface.
Okay, Houston. The moon is essentially gray. No color. Looks like plaster of Paris. Sort of a grayish beach sand.
There we are, just 60 miles from the moon's surface, slowly watching the craters slip by underneath. And we're like, you know, three school kids, you know, looking at those craters go by. And so that was quite a sight.
The craters are all rounded off. There's quite a few of them. Some of them are newer.
This was the first time man had seen alive the far side of the moon for millions of years.
Langridus is quite a huge crater. It's got a central cone to it.
They had made it. They had proved that humans could get into close orbit around the moon, and they were now at the staging point from which Apollo 11 would later begin its final 13 minutes of descent.
As we come around the nearest side, we pass the Sea of Fertility, then go right over the Sea of Tranquility and look for suitable landing sites there.
The walls of the crater are terraced. About six or seven different terraces on the way down.
Then, on their third orbit around the moon, they saw something that took their breath away.
Oh my God, look at that picture over there. There's the Earth coming up. Wow, is that pretty?
They saw the Earth, a burst of color rising above the desolate lunar surface. And 50 years later, you can still hear the awe in Jim Lovell's voice.
You know, I started to think, wow, that's home. And as we came around farther, I could go to the window and put up my thumb, and I could completely hide the Earth behind my thumb. You have to think about that. Over 5 billion people. Everything I ever knew, I could hide behind my thumb. As I looked at the Earth, I said, well, it's just a small body, a small planet, just one of nine in our solar system. The Earth is a mere speck in our Milky Way galaxy, and it's lost to oblivion in the universe. It starts to make you think your position in the whole universe.
On board the spacecraft, the astronauts scrambled around for a camera. Photography was supposed to be Bill Ander's responsibility, but Jim Lovell pulled rank.
He was trying to do it on the right window. The composition was horrible. On my left window, with the lunar horizon coming down like this and the Earth coming up like this, perfect.
Bill, I got it framed. It's very clear right here. Got it?
Yep.
Take several.
Take several of them. Here, give me some. Let me just get the right setting here. Calm down, Mama.
Well, I got it right. Oh, that's a beautiful shot.
So I brought Bill over with his camera, set up up there, told him how to compose the picture.
250 at F11.
And then said, now push that button right over there.
I hope he gave you some of the royalties.
Yeah.
It's the photograph we've come to know as Earth Riots, one of the most famous pictures ever taken. It shows our Earth as a brilliant but small, blue, fragile marble, alone in the vastness of space. It changed the way we saw our home forever and helped us understand our role as custodians of this planet. In 1968, that beautiful, colourful, vulnerable planet had experienced war, protests, and political assassinations. But on Christmas Eve, an estimated 1 billion people tuned in to a broadcast by the Apollo 8 crew.
The moon is a different thing to each one of us. I know my own impression is that it's a vast, lonely, forbidding type existence.
It makes you realize just
just what you have back there on Earth. The Earth from here is a grand oasis of the big vastness of space.
I think the thing that impressed me the most were the lunar sunrises and sunsets.
Then, with the world listening, the astronauts did something that no one back on Earth was expecting.
Now you can see the long shadows of the lunar sunrise. And for all the people back on Earth, the crew of Apollo 8 has a message that we would like to send to you. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness.
It was like, wow. Where'd that come from? The hair stood up on the back of my neck.
And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning.
Nobody on the ground or in the control center, that I don't think knew anything about it. And it was just mind-boggling. You know, the brought tears to my eyes, and most of the people in the control center, to think, okay, here it's Christmas Eve, and we have Americans circling the moon, and they're reading about the creation of Earth and the universe by God, and it's just overwhelming.
And God called the dry land Earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. And God saw that it was good. And from the crew of Apollo 8, we close with good night, good luck, a Merry Christmas, and God bless all of you on the good Earth.
Shortly after they'd spoken those words, the Apollo 8 astronauts began their preparations to come home. On Christmas Day, they fired their engine, and once again, Mission Control waited nervously.
Apollo 8, Houston. Apollo 8, Houston.
Houston, Apollo 8, over.
Hello, Apollo 8. Loud and clear. You're the best one to know.
They were on their way home, back towards the beautiful but imperfect world they had left behind at the end of a troubled year. But only as the messages of congratulations poured into NASA did flight controllers like John Aaron start to realize how important the mission had been.
As we came around the moon and we were sailing downwind toward the Earth, telegrams started coming in. Congratulations, telegrams and telegrams. But the one I remember the most, it was the one from a woman from somewhere, and I forget where she was from. She wrote this little telegram. She said, dear NASA, all of these things have happened so far this year to this country. You took us around the moon on Christmas. Thank you for saving 1968.
Apollo 8 was a turning point in NASA's fortunes, a mission undertaken at huge risk, but one which put the Apollo 1 fire firmly behind them. The courageous decision to push on and chance everything on Apollo 8's flight to the moon had paid off. 50 years later, I asked Jim Lovell about Apollo 8's legacy.
Is that what you think that we should take most from Project Apollo, our place in the universe, the fragility of Earth, now insignificance against the backdrop of the universe?
I kind of think that, you know, there's a reason why we're here. I'm not a very religious person, but when I looked at the Earth itself and I started to wonder why I was here, what's my purpose here, how do I figure out what I see, you know?
And then it sort of dawned on me, and my perspective is that God has given mankind a stage upon which to perform. How the play turns out is up to us.
Half a century on, and the legacy of Apollo 8 is clear. Arguably the most impressive feat of exploration in the history of human spaceflight, Apollo 8 did more than simply set the stage for Apollo 11's historic first landing. It changed the way we saw ourselves and our place in the universe. It helped us understand the beauty and fragility of everything we have. But in 1968, it was all about the mission. The next act in humanity's great exploration could now be written, thanks to the star performances of Lovell, Borman and Anders, and scientists and engineers like Poppy Northcutt, Jerry Bostick and John Aaron. And one of Apollo 8's supporting players would soon be thrust into the limelight. In Episode 7, we'll get to know Command Module Pilot Michael Collins, who, along with Armstrong and Aldrin, completed the Apollo 11 crew. And while they undertook their 13-minute descent to the surface, Collins kept watch, waiting to rescue them should things go wrong, understanding the enormity of his responsibility.
On Apollo 11, I think we, the crew, felt the whole weight of the world on our shoulders. We felt like people were going to watch us, and if any mistake we made, particularly Russians, would be watching us. So we felt a grave responsibility, and when Neil and Buzz were on the surface and I was by myself, then I felt the responsibility for getting the three of us home in one piece. So I was gravely concerned from liftoff to touchdown on Earth.
13 Minutes to the Moon is an original podcast from the BBC World Service.
Before Christmas and way out in space, the Apollo 8 crew had just won the moon race. Frank sprang to his couch, to the ship gave a thrust, and away they all flew past the gray lunar dust. But we heard them explain ere they flew round the moon, Merry Christmas to Earth, we'll be back there real soon. Great job, gang.
13 Minutes to the Moon is produced by Chris Browning and Andrew Luck Baker. Our theme music is by Hans Zimmer. Extra production and research effort is by Sue Norton and Madeline Finley. The series editor is Rami Zabar, and podcast editor is John Minnell. Many thanks to Tom Green, NASA and the Johnson Space Center Oral History Project for archive material. Special thanks to the WHRO What Matters TV show for the use of Katherine Johnson's interview. And thanks to all of you for posting your comments, ratings and reviews. That's very much appreciated. Please keep them coming. Our hashtag is 13 Minutes to the Moon. That's all one word. We've put the famous Earthrise photograph on our website, along with lots of other Apollo photos, videos and documents at bbcworldservice.com/13minutes. I'm Kevin Fong. Thanks for listening.